I am absolutely delighted to be here. This is my first opportunity to work directly with on Carl's platform. As he mentioned, we have repeatedly engaged him in our leadership development and other professional development programs. My pharmacy colleagues here know that I have been passionate since the day I was born in pharmacy about the contributions that pharmacists can make to quality health care. You know, why is it that pharmacy seems to be so on this? I said, well, it's really kind of easy. Medication use is a team sport. Regardless of which discipline you represent here today, your discipline has something to do with medication use. And we now are excited that increasingly pharmacists are part of the team that are trying to make sense of all of it. And I think the evidence is reasonably, it's growing if not replete, that when you get the medication use part right, good things can happen in healthcare. So this has become my passion platform for integrating, fully integrating my discipline into the changing world of healthcare. So what is IPE? And there's lots of different ways to define it, but most of us elect to use this 2010 definition from the World Health Organization that when students from two or more professions learn about, from, and with each other to enable effective collaboration and improve health outcomes, that is interprofessional education. What became really clear as those were beginning to come to the communities of interest was that without that compelling rationale, you know, we could keep doing this education stuff for a long time. But the evidence is strongest that when people, health practitioners, work in teams, especially with complex patients, and they work in effective teams, those patient outcomes are better by and large. And the literature is reasonably strong there. So I wanted to introduce you to my team today. And probably most of you recognize at least two of the people on this slide, in this picture. Rick Valakovic is my counterpart from dentistry, then me. Polly Bednash is the honored guest that evening, I'll come back to that, at nursing. The tall man behind her is Steve Shannon from osteopathic medicine. Carol Ashenbrenner from the allopathic medicine, AAMC. And then the gentleman to the left is Harrison Spencer, who is my counterpart from the schools and programs of public health. So in January 2009, at the suggestion of AAMC, but at the invitation of AACP, the six of us, pictured on that previous slide, met in the Four Seasons Hotel. It was icy outside. We almost didn't have the meeting because it was kind of sort of dangerous to get there. But we decided that it was hard enough to find a date on our calendar when all of us could, that we would go ahead and use the day. And we started out talking about what is it going to take to meet the needs, known and growing needs of our members to make interprofessional education mainstream across our disciplines and between and among our disciplines. The six of us believed for some reason that day that we were onto something important. And we began to elucidate the things that needed to be done in order to help our members introduce and implement and sustain IPE. We decided that we needed to start by creating a shared language and competencies, a framework for competencies, that indisputably that faculty would need professional development to learn how to facilitate team-based learning on their campuses and in their curriculum. That there weren't adequate resources yet, and did it make any sense for everybody to think that they had to make up the cases and the simulations and the other things themselves? Couldn't we do some aggregation of that? And basically, we've been going around this circle for the last 5 years. We needed to identify the exemplary models that were available and could be shown to learners, but also to faculty to create. And ultimately, there would be important work to do in the context of clinical and translational work, research to build the body of evidence that if we teach you how to practice in a team-based fashion, that you can practice in a team-based fashion, and that your patients' outcomes are better. And there's always an underlying conversation that needs to be had with policymakers. And so we have just been going around the circle. As we have embarked on our work, and there's more to share with you about some of the other things we've done around that circle to date, we've learned some things, and a lot of it we've learned from the people that have come to our interprofessional institutes, our faculty development institutes. But in general, we would argue that beginning IPE experiences early in the curriculum is critically important. There's a tendency to say, oh, they're going to be working in teams when they're out in their clinical, whether that's early clinical or advanced clinical at the end of their experience. It's too late, because a lot of professional identity formation has actually happened in some cases before they even apply to our schools, as I think you recognize. But if we begin to introduce team-based care as a construct that's important to them regardless of discipline, and the fact that they have a responsibility and the opportunities to understand and appreciate the roles of other players, then their students will be more active learners within that space. And I know that there are a number of schools, Pitt among them, that now incorporate some based IPE work in a shared orientation activity for all of their learners right the very first week that they're in their professional disciplines. It needs to center on the patient, whether that's a real patient or a simulated patient. We did a field trip to Hofstra University Medical School, a brand new medical school in Long Island. Their M3, M4 class is starting just now. They have shaken up and broken every rule of allopathic medical education known to man, including their students become certified EMTs in the first 9 weeks of medical school. I understand that Northwestern does the same thing. So if you can imagine that, you can't become an EMT unless you're riding on ambulances and seeing blood and birthing babies and doing that, and they're doing it in the first 9 weeks of their medical education. So there's some ways to really look at it. But students will tell you that if they aren't focusing on patient care in the IPE experience, and they don't have a meaningful role to play as learners, you're just, you know, I don't know how to characterize what a non-meaningful role, but you really have to engage them. Otherwise, it seems peripheral, and they're going to discount the importance of it. And that sets us back. And then, most importantly, a one shot and done isn't going to help them learn how to be team ready when they leave your programs. They need to have a variety of different exposures, didactic, experiential, co-curricular, extracurricular. We received a Macy grant, and Macy Foundation has been an amazing supporter of IPE activities across many years. And there is now dedicated resources on AAMC's Open Access MedEd portal. It's just MedEd portal. Just put that into Google and you'll get right there. And you'll find teaching and assessment resources, as well as in their section of MedEd portal called iCollaborative, a very dynamic sharing architecture. MedEd portal itself is all peer-reviewed material, and that takes time to get the material to that point. But iCollaborative is very much more dynamic than that. About a year and a half ago, University of Minnesota was awarded a contract from HRSA to create the National Center for Interprofessional Practice and Education. Barbara Brandt, a pharmacy faculty member, but who also works across the administration of the AHC at Minnesota, is the head of that. And they're coalescing a lot of resources at what they call the nexus of interprofessional learning and practice. Because what became very clear from the health systems representatives involved in our discussion about interprofessional learning and team-based care is if there is no linkage between those two, then neither will be successful. And we have bought into that completely. Our two higher priorities for going forward to sort of complete our plan relate to leadership for interprofessional education and the need for tools for assessment in interprofessional education. A synthesis of what we learned when we were talking about what leadership is required for IPE is that it is in fact both a top-down and a bottom-up phenomenon. In those cases where you've got a passionate champion or two or three or four, they're going to do a lot, and they're going to work hard at introducing something or some things, but it's probably not sustainable if it's not recognized from up above and there isn't a champion at the top. It doesn't have to be the president or the provost necessarily, but some signature upper administration official has to also be doing the pull to the push of the passionate champions. The passionate champions can be anyone. I was trying to think about whether I would make a recommendation to you that it needs to be the department chair. Can be. Needs to be the associate dean. Needs to be a faculty member. I don't know that that necessarily is the case. But as department chairs, even if you're not at the table, you do have a critically important role to play in validating that the time that whomever is spending on IPE planning and execution is valued and is celebrated and is rewarded. Jay Perman said, you can't be successful unless your university is prepared to put real resources on the table and not just lip service. And that's real resources in people and dedicated time, in faculty development. At Maryland, they've done that, plus they've created funds that faculty can compete for to support projects. And those are just a couple of the different ways that real resources need to be brought to bear. When a team is brought together, they should start by inventorying what actually is going on right now already on our campus, and they might be surprised, either with how much or how little. And then, again, it's equally important, probably more important, to use carrots and sticks. But the bottom line is the sticks are out there now. The accrediting bodies are actually meeting together to talk about accreditation of IPE and how they might use some of the same metrics in order to evaluate the progress of their program. And the last word I have for you is the good news is you're not starting from scratch. There are actually boatloads, and this is just a few of the aggregations of resources that are available to you online. Thank you so much for inviting me and for your attention.